Welcome to the latest episode of Tech of the Week from Trusted Reviews. First of all, we should begin this week's episode with a short apology. We were not here last week because we were doing something related to Black Friday, some promotional season or something or other.
Yeah, so I've heard about it. I'm not really sure what it is exactly. Yeah.
So the reason why we weren't here in front of the camera is because we were locked in a room scouring the internet for some of the best tech deals going. So
how fun that was!
Yeah, it was fun. And if you were able to pick up any deals yourself, let us know. I myself didn't because I couldn't find anything that I kind of needed or wanted, and also because I'm broke. But you guys picked up a couple of bargains, right?
I mean, I have a credit card, so I'm still broke. I just kind of have delayed my brokenness.
I got a
49-inch LG 4K HDR TV, and I haven't owned a TV ever, really. I mean, my parents have one, but I've actually been watching TV off a computer monitor for like the last 4 years.
So this is your first.
It's my first actual TV. It's very exciting, and then I wall mounted it, and that was terrifying. So far, still on the wall.
Okay.
So far, good. A Black Friday success, in my opinion.
And Ryan, how about you?
Well, I got a Nintendo Switch after mine got stolen a few months ago. So
shit, I forgot about that.
Yeah. So it's nice to actually finally be able to play like Mario and Pokemon again. So that's good.
So your Switch got stolen, if I'm right, right before Nintendo introduced cloud saves, right?
Yeah, like big kick in the groin. Yeah. So I've got to start from scratch on all the games. So I guess that's an excuse to play Breath of the Wild again. So
definitely not too bad a thing, really, is it?
Exactly.
That's a positive way of looking at it, definitely. Because I'd love to be able to start that game from scratch and play.
Exactly.
Fresh eyes.
It's beautiful.
So no, it could like wipe my memory as well, but never mind.
Don't take that as a cue to rob me of my Nintendo Switch, though, because I'd be very sad. Please don't do that. At least not until I've enabled cloud saves. Anyway, so that was tech of last week. This is tech of this week. Toddy, what have you got here?
I have a phone, as per usual.
Okay.
I think this is the second or third phone I've brought in, but this is the Xiaomi Mi 8 Pro.
Xiaomi Mi 8 Pro.
So the day before the Trust Reviews Awards, which you might remember from a couple of weeks back, I was at the launch event for Xiaomi in the UK. Xiaomi is a huge mobile brand in other markets, actually a huge brand outright. They make all sorts of things from smart home and connected home stuff to they have electric scooters and all sorts of other things in between. But mobile is a big part of their business. And they've now formally launched in the UK, and this is their first device, kind of their flagship for the UK.
Okay.
So it's like the best kind of meter stick to measure it by is probably the OnePlus 6 or the OnePlus 6T. So it's a flagship class phone with a fairly competitive price point and some really good specs beyond
it
the processor.
Really, really nice.
Yeah, it does.
The big highlight is the back, because it's got this crazy kind of like translucent back.
Oh, cool.
With these fake, they look like real chips, but they're all fake chips on the back. But it means you can like kind of see the components.
So those aren't actually proper components.
They're not proper components.
Is that just a picture of a Snapdragon?
They are actually 3D if you see the new cast of shadow. So it's quite nice. And Xiaomi was actually saying they've put Easter eggs in all the writing.
Oh wow.
So there's like writing relating to like, you know, the company's launch date and things like this. It's quite cool.
That's so cool, yeah.
So it's a nice little, it's a bit of a different approach to smartphone design, especially when, you know, every millimeter counts. It's quite frivolous, but I kind of like that.
It's super frivolous, but I like that.
Yeah.
So that's like a Potemkin village processor, basically.
It would be a shame if the phone then was a bit rubbish, but it really isn't. It's very, very good. The camera I'm particularly impressed with, dual 12 meg, lossless zoom, optical image stabilization, everything you'd expect on a flagship phone. And this phone is £499.
Okay.
So it's like half the price of like, you know, an iPhone or a Pixel almost. And you get almost the same experience. Like the screen's really nice.
You get a notch as well.
Yeah, it's got a really, really big notch. That is one of the criticisms. Like, it's not quite like the Pixel 3 XLs, which like cuts into the display by like a foot. But it's really wide as well, dominates a lot the front. The advantage in Xiaomi's eyes is that there's also an IR camera in there, so you can have face unlock in low light. So that's why it's so big.
That's good.
So it is justified, but
I'm not too fussed about that huge notch, to be honest.
Relative to the proportions of the phone, it's okay.
Exactly.
I think. And yeah, the software's really good. It's got some performance issues, which I talk about in the full written review, which is, of course, already on trustedreviews.com if you want to go read that. But it's solid all around, and I think if the brand can kind of capture people's attention, then I think they've got a real winner on their hands.
Yeah.
Xiaomi.
I'm not sure. It's X. X-I-A-O-M-I.
Gonna spend a whole year trying to figure out one out of them, probably.
Yeah, and I've been calling it the Mi 8 Pro, but apparently it's Mi 8 M-I, but Mi, pronounced Mi. So that's the thing. And we should also be getting the Mi 8 in soon as well. The standard Mi 8 is the Pro. The UK is actually the first market outside of China to get this phone as well, which is really cool. So
really trying to
punch into this market in a big way. And I think this spells kind of good things in the future.
Sure.
Hashtag Brexit Britain.
I guess. Sure. But yeah, so that's me and that's the Mi 8
Pro. We have to be optimistic about these things, right?
For sure. Yeah, otherwise we'd cry.
So that was Alex Todd, Alex Walker Todd.
Hello.
And now over to Ryan Jones. Ryan, I want you to show me the way. What have you got here?
Oh my God. Well, it looks like I've got the HTC Vive, and obviously this is not a new product.
It's old.
Yeah, exactly. But it's actually, I'm showing you the wireless adapter. So basically, this now allows you to, well, like it says on the tin, to play wirelessly. So you don't have to be tripping over cables every time you play. Like, you guys have played VR, haven't you?
Yes.
Like, you know how irritating it can be, like in the middle of a shootout, or you're doing whatever, and then you're suddenly tripping over a cable or having to like untangle it.
I was saying to you earlier, like, with all of the reviews when these headsets first came out, that was like always a criticism. Like, exactly. It's great that you now have VR on your PC, but having that big tether was always cumbersome.
Especially with like room scale VR as well. Yeah. Like if you're sitting on your chair, it's not too bad, but when you're walking around, just a pain.
It can really take you out of the immersion, I find, when you have this umbilical cord just like knocking against your leg. It's like, oh yeah. I'm not actually in the Matrix.
In the dining room.
So this eliminates that. You've still got like a battery pack kind of dangling down, but you just clip it onto your belt, put the cable onto your t-shirt, and like it's kind of problem solved.
So does it attach to the headset itself, or where does it go?
So this will clip onto the band here.
Okay.
So I'll try and do it now as a demonstration how easy it is. I'll probably mess this up now.
No pressure. No blue Peter, we made one earlier.
So you've got this bit of Velcro here.
Yeah.
And then slip it on this slip here. And then the Velcro's sticking now. Things always go wrong when you least mean.
When you're trying to do it in one take, yeah.
Yep. Slip this underneath.
So that thing's
going
to be on top of your head.
On top of your head,
it sits on your crown.
So
it looks like.
Honestly, it does look a bit odd. Like, I think you look a little bit like an alien Teletubby or something.
Imagine that.
Or some sort of robot beetle.
Robot beetle is a good example. You know? But Velcro is not going to me.
Remember those?
Yeah, unfortunately, I do.
There you go.
Yeah.
So that's now clipped on. I can do it more securely, and I'm doing it properly. But for now, I think that'll justify. And if I put it on, I guess you can see what it looks like.
Please, please do. We have to see you look like a cyborg Teletubby.
There you go.
I mean, VR, no one looks cool in VR anyway.
Exactly.
Like, so it doesn't really matter,
so,
I suppose.
Yeah, but if you're really self-conscious about how you look like in VR, then it's kind of VR's not for you. I forgot to plug the cables in as well. And these cables just quick, easily just slip in here.
Oh, I see. So they're plugged in front. I did wonder what it's
plugged. I was going to ask.
Yeah, just start dangling down. That's a pretty important thing to put the cables in.
But usually those plug into the link box that comes with the Vive.
Exactly.
So is there something on the other end for the link box to get?
Or so have you have like a wireless receiver
where
you plug into your computer. But here's the catch. You've got to get this wireless. I think it's a WGI card, and you've got to plug it directly into the motherboard. Well, it's a bit of a pain.
Whoa.
If you like to dabble with your computer components all the time, that's not much of an issue.
Sure.
But if you don't like to open up your computer, or if you've got a laptop, it won't even work on a laptop.
Right.
That's a crazy prerequisite to have wireless functionality. Like, I'm surprised if they brought it to market like that.
Exactly.
You would have thought they just have a USB plug and play it.
Yeah, well, there's I think it's called the TP-Link wireless adapter, which kind of does the same thing.
Okay. And can that just plug in to your computer?
That can bundle with a router. So you plug it, like I said, you plug it into the back of your computer.
Right.
The problem with that is the latency isn't as great as this one.
Okay.
So you have a little bit of a delay. This is like almost, I've played with it a few hours, didn't notice any delay whatsoever.
So that is as good as a wired experience in terms of latency.
As good as a wired experience.
Right.
But
how long does it last as well if it's wireless, obviously?
So you have a battery pack and that lasts about 2.5 hours. It's up to 2.5 hours.
That's
we got around
decent.
That figure. It's pretty good. And you can charge the power pack up via USB-C as well, so that's obviously pretty handy.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
It takes quite a while to charge it up, probably around, I haven't done the exact figure, but I've quoted around 10 hours maybe.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
So way longer than it is for use. That's kind of annoying.
Yeah. So I had it on charge for about 3 hours and it wasn't even nearly halfway.
Right.
So it's quite a long time.
Then again, I suppose you're going to be, when you're playing VR games, you're typically only in for like 15, 20 minutes, right?
Exactly.
So, yeah. You're not really going to be wanting to max out those 2 hours or so. You
Unless
know.
You're me trying to play through Lone Echo in like a single sitting, which is a bit crazy.
So I've never really sat that comfortably with VR games myself. I'm one of those people who gets like motion sickness and a kind of like annoying headache a little bit afterwards. So like 2.5 hours would be more than plenty for me.
Yeah, for sure.
So I don't get ill from or sick from VR, but like I said, 2 hours is probably around about the max I'd do.
Right.
So it's not really a problem about the battery life. You just have a bit play with it, put it down, put it on charge, next time you come back to it, fine. So I don't think that's an issue. I think one of the biggest issues with it is the price.
Right.
How much?
£299. Pretty expensive.
Wow. Right, and the Vive on its own is not cheap already, right?
Not cheap already. Yeah. I think that's, I think it's got changing price all the time, but I think that's still around £500 right. with all the things to
plus
go with
the,
it.
Plus the like £1,000 computer you need to run.
Exactly.
VR game.
Yeah. Well, to
that's
put things
crazy.
In context, it's so crazy. Like, considering you can get now and get like a PlayStation VR headset for about $250.
Less than the adapter.
The wireless adapter is more expensive than the PlayStation VR headset. Wow.
And I presume that works the same with the Vive Pro?
Works with the Vive Pro. Right. You need to pay a little bit more extra to get the right adapter.
You need to pay more?
A little bit more.
Oh my god, HTC, what are you doing?
But but yeah, it still works wow. with the Vive Pro. What the TP-Link doesn't work with Vive Pro. So if you go with Vive Pro, this is the only one to
right.
go for.
Right. So cool that it exists, but goddamn.
Yeah.
Goddamn HTC.
I think unless you've got money burning in your pocket, I think it's probably best to wait until the next generation of headsets. And wireless will probably be like, well, hopefully integrated into these new headsets. So
you'd hope so, yeah.
But if you can't wait for that now, because obviously wires are pain, I understand that, then this is available to buy right now, so.
Cool.
And performance is like slick, like pretty good.
Cool.
Nice. And then Tom, what have you brought to the table?
So I have here in my hand
the table we don't have.
This is the metaphorical table.
Yes.
Yes. So this is the Acer Switch 7. It is a convertible laptop.
Any relation to the Nintendo Switch by any chance?
No relation to the Nintendo Switch. That is a head-to-head I would quite like to see actually, because if we could get like ARMS or Smash Brothers running on this, that'd be pretty cool.
That'd be pretty sweet.
Maybe. So it's like a Microsoft Surface Pro. It comes with a detachable keyboard dock. Cool. You can flip that around and attach it like so. And you can use it as a tablet. And then you can detach it and pop it back on again. And it's like a conventional laptop. One of the things that I think is really compelling about this as an offer is that you don't have to buy the keyboard dock separately. A lot of the time...
I was going to ask about that.
Yeah, so the Surface Pro range is fantastic, but, you know, despite all of the posters that you'll see on the tube and things like that, where it comes with the keyboard dock attached and the stylus positions neatly alongside it, you don't actually get that in the box. You have to pay for it separately.
And they're expensive separately.
And
well.
Yeah, they're not cheap either, but with the Acer Switch 7, not only do you get the keyboard dock included in the box.
Oh, damn!
Oh!
There's a Wacom stylus included in there as well.
That's so nicely hidden, actually.
It is quite nicely hidden, too, yeah. It's. I haven't finished reviewing this yet. I've run a review in progress so far, because I've only tested this as we would do a conventional laptop, tablet-type device. I haven't really been able to explore any of the artistic applications of it yet. The Wacom stylus supports 4,096 levels of pressure sensitivity.
Cool.
I'm not an especially good artist myself, so...
I saw you doodling earlier.
Yeah,
I was scribbling away earlier, and,
Do you want me to hold that?
No, it's fine. I got this.
You got this.
My professional opinion on this as a non-professional illustrator is perhaps... not worth the paper it's printed on. I can't even attach this. What the hell is going on?
Boom.
This is going in the on the cutting room floor, right? No? Okay. Right. So let's have a look and see what we can do in terms of drawing. So like I said, I haven't had a lot of time to experiment with
beautiful.
Nice.
That's awesome.
The art applications just yet. But so I took a little selfie and Rob, I don't know if you can focus in on that here.
That's just a normal selfie, look.
There you go, that's what I look like in real life. So, you know, when I make an effort, my hair looks like this. It's been fun. I've had a lot of fun messing around with this. And it's a little too soon for me to deliver an early verdict on it yet. The early benchmarking tests that I have done don't bode that well, I have to be honest. The battery life is particularly poor. It's about 3.5 hours, 3 hours, 45 minutes.
Okay, that's not great, is it?
Which is not great, but then again, I think that's kind of, I don't know, would you say that's common for tablets, or?
I mean, it depends on I'm curious as to what processor that's running as well.
Right.
That obviously would steer me as to whether or not that's good or bad.
It's an 8th Gen i7.
Not like a Y series or anything, it's a standard.
No, it's a U series.
Okay, then I'm not that surprised by that kind of battery longevity. Like, it's not great though, like.
No.
Then again, the Core i5 Surface Pro 6 that we tested recently had a much better battery life than this. Mm. So, that's not a like for like comparison, obviously, but, yeah, 3.5 hours is kind of not good. That's like gaming laptop levels.
But without gaming.
It does have a dedicated GPU, but it's an MX 150. So again, it's not like a GTX 1060 or anything like that. Yeah. So
initial impression so far, would you take that over the Surface Pro 6?
It's certainly cheaper. And the fact that you get a stylus and a keyboard dock included, if that's important to you, it certainly looks like a better value buy. However, the thing about having an optional keyboard dock and an optional stylus with your tablet hybrid is that it's optional. If you don't need a stylus, then you can save yourself £100. But the stylus comes included whether you need one or not. So I don't know, the jury's out on this just yet. I do like this. There's a lot of, the screen's really good. It's bigger than the 12-inch screen you get on the Surface Pros. But it's the speakers that you get either side here, they support Dolby technology, so music that I've played through this sounds pretty decent.
You were also raving about the something on the back, the metal stand.
Right,
thing.
Yeah. So the kickstand is pretty high quality as well. You just pop it out like that.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, that's pretty.
And
sick.
Unlike a lot of similar tablets, will have like a cheapy plastic stand. This is solid metal.
That's
so. You have that set up on your desk.
Yeah.
You have the keyboard dock attached, and sometimes with other tablets, I found that because the kickstand's a little flimsy, you're typing away and you just accidentally start shunting the thing across your desk.
Yeah.
This thing doesn't move at all, and I've been sort of hammering away at reviews and reports on this for the last few days, and it's pretty solid. So that is good as well.
Yeah. So I've used tablets with like a stand on train and like a little bit of shaking is like falling over straight away.
I lost the Nexus 9, which came with a magnetic dock before, and the whole thing, I was on a bus and I was sitting in the middle seat in the aisle and I went over a bump and the whole tablet just backflipped off the case and I was like, oh god.
Oh my god.
Yeah, so yeah, that was not a good case or stand set up.
I hope someone was filming that.
Sadly, no, but yeah.
When you've been framed with that?
It's just emblazoned in my brain though. I don't like seeing tech get tortured, so that was pretty bad.
No. It is sad when you drop something.
Yeah.
So I shouldn't mock because those are sad times. But this thing is pretty solid. I think this would probably stay standing up in the event of an earthquake.
Damn.
Which is not part of our standard testing criteria. So I can't really back that up.
But we should integrate that though.
It should be.
Just
like
with someone on a table, we just shake it. You know?
Shake the table. I'd be up for that. That's the Acer Switch 7 so far. Like I said, I think it's got a lot going for it, and I think the price is compelling, especially compared to the closest equivalent in Microsoft's Surface Pro 6 range. But I need to do more testing on this before I can say whether it's a decent alternative or not.
Sure. Are we going to see the review on that within the week, or do you think it'll take a little bit longer to get it all wrapped up?
If we don't have another Black Friday type event now and next week, then I would say yes.
Yeah, I should mention as well, half the office is off ill because of like Black Friday just wiped everyone out.
Yeah.
So yeah,
we're the last one standing.
With survivors, yeah, just about. But cool.
In the post Black Friday apocalyptic wasteland, it is just we three left, and Rob, who you can't see because he's behind the camera. So That's Tech of the Week for this week. Thanks very much for watching. If you've got any comments or questions, I'm looking in the wrong camera. Hi. If you have any comments or questions for us, please leave them in the comments and stay tuned, and we will see you next week.
Clap, so I've got a nice little ending marker.
Okay, if you want. Why are we doing this again?
So you can sync up the audio and the visual.
All the on same both time.
All right, 1, 2, 3.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
What, lipstick?
Yeah. Do you want more?
Lipstick? I haven't got any on.
You walked into that
one. I did.
Out of order. So you can make it a 100.
Baby Shark.